Father and God, we give you thanks and praise for your words. We thank you, God, that you are still alive and well today. Oh God, your word says that the flower faded and the grass withered, but your words will last forever. And so, God, as we seek to hear from you again this morning, we ask, oh God, that you help us not just to be hearers of the word, but, oh God, help us to be doers. Help us to become the word incarnate. This we do pray in Jesus' precious name. Amen and amen. We began the quarter by looking at the seven I ams of Jesus recorded in the Gospel of John. We began, however, in the book of Exodus chapter 3, where God told Moses to tell the people that I am that I am. In other words, I will be what I choose to be so that they can have the confidence that everything that they need me to be, I will be so that they can have their deliverance from Egyptian slavery. I'm glad, brothers and sisters, that the God we serve is still the great I am, a God who will be there for us in every situation. When we're down, he'll be our up. When we're sad, he's our joy. When we're hungry, is our food. Whatever we need him to be, God has promised that he will be there. Now we began in the Gospel of John looking at I am the living bread. And then we spoke about the fact that God says, Jesus says, don't just serve me for temporal bread. Don't just come looking for me because you need me to satisfy a temporal blessing. Come seek me because you want a feast of the living bread that satisfies eternally. We looked at the word, and the word said that there were those who came looking for Jesus, looking for the bread, because he had just given over 5,000 fish and bread. Then we talked about the light. Jesus says that I am the light, and we said back then that God wants us to have more than just enough light to survive, but he wants us to have enough light that we can produce food. We said then that many of us have enough light to stay green. We talk about ourselves as plants needing light, and we said that we have enough light to stay green, enough light to come to church, but not enough light to produce food. God wants us to understand that Jesus is indeed the light of the world. Then we talked about the door. I am the door. I believe we had two doors. And we said that God wants us to understand that he is more than just a door of opportunity. You remember that? But he is also a door that requires a commitment, faithfulness. God doesn't want us just to come seeking him just for temporal positions. And then we talked about God being the good shepherd, Jesus being the good shepherd. And we said then that the good shepherd knows the sheep and the sheep knows the good shepherd. They hear his voice and they follow. And we questioned ourselves as to whether or not we were indeed good sheep or bad sheep, because he's a good shepherd. And if we are good sheep, we wouldn't recognize the voice of the shepherd. You remember that? And then we talked about Jesus being the resurrection and the life. And we said that there are some things that will be dead, and only Jesus can resurrect it. We said that we can't bring living things to be resurrected. We must bring those dead things that has been dead for a very long time to Jesus so he can resurrect them. Or relationships. Bring them to Jesus. They might be dead. He can resurrect them. And then we spoke of Jesus being the way, the truth, and the life, and I wanted to make it clear to you last time that Jesus being the way is not a way that we attempt to, and at some point we stop because we get weary or because we become discouraged. You know, in order for us to understand and accept Jesus Christ as the way, we have to be willing to go with him all the way. So even though this Christian experience may get tiresome sometimes and difficult sometimes, we have to make a commitment to follow Jesus all the way. He's also the truth and the life. And we said that in order for us to be saved, in order for us to inherit eternal life, we must accept Jesus. He is the only way, he is the only truth, and he is, in fact, the life. Allow me now just for a few moments to share with you the next and the last I am statement of Jesus. I am the true vine, as we read in our scripture reading. I am the true vine. Let's look at this, however, under the caption, the evidence is overwhelming. I want to get a little close to you. I want to tell you something today. I think it's very important for us to hear and to see clearly. The evidence is overwhelming. The Bible says in verse 1, I am brothers and sisters? The true vine, and my Father is what? I am the true vine, and my Father is the husbandman. It suggests to me, brothers and sisters, that there is a true vine and a false vine. Are you seeing the Bible with me? The text says that I am the true vine. Jesus says, I'm not just a vine, but I'm the true vine. And my Father is the husbandman. So brothers and sisters, when I read that, I said to myself, if Jesus is saying, I'm the true vine, then there must be a false vine. And I think it's important for us to identify what's truth and what's error. Because sometimes you see truth looks like error, sounds like error, and sometimes error sounds like truth and looks like truth. We must be careful as Seventh-day Adventists, born-again Christians, to know the difference clearly between truth and error. Jesus says, I am the true vine. And I've got to do some Bible study to find out, then who is the false vine? Go with me to Isaiah chapter 5. Let's do a little quick Bible study. I'm not going to make it up. I want to show it to you in the Bible. Isaiah chapter 5 and verse 1. Isaiah chapter 5 and verse 1. The Bible says, now will I sing to my well-beloved a song of my beloved, touching his what? Vineyard. My well-beloved at a vineyard in a very what? Fruitful hill. Verse 2. The Bible says, and he fenced it and gathered out the stones thereof and planted it, the choicest vine, and built a tower in the midst of it and also made a winepress therein. And he looked that it should bring forth what? Grapes. And it brought forth what? Wild grapes. Verse 3. And now, O inhabitants of Jerusalem and men of Judah, judge, I pray you, betwixt me and what? My vineyard. What, verse 4, what could have been done more to my vineyard that I have not done in it? Wherefore, when I looked that it should bring forth grapes, brought it forth what? Wild grapes. Verse 5. And now, go, I will tell you what I will do with my vineyard. I will take away the hedge thereof, and it shall be what? Eaten up, and break down the wall thereof, and it shall what? Be trodden down. Verse 6. And I will lay it what? Waste. It shall be pruned, not be pruned, nor digged, but there shall come up briars and thorns. I will also command the clouds that they rain no rain upon it. Verse 7. For the vineyard of the Lord of hosts is what, everybody? Oh, God help us here today. The Bible says, for the vineyard of the Lord of hosts is the house of what? Israel. And the men of what? Judah is what? Pleasant. And he looked for what? Judgment. But behold, oppression. For righteousness, but behold a cry. Look with me one more text. Psalms, the 80th division of the Psalms, Psalms 80 and verse 8. I want to show you clearly. I'm not going to make it up. Psalms 80 and verse 8 says, thou hast brought a vine out of everybody, Egypt. Thou hast what? Cast out the heathen and what? Brothers and sisters, when Jesus says, I am the true vine, is referred to the fact that he had a vine once. A vine that he planted, that he nourished. But instead of that vine bringing forth good grapes, it brought forth wild grapes. The vine here, brothers and sisters, that Jesus is referring to as the false vine by implication is Israel. Israel was supposed to be a true vine, a true representation of Jesus, but Israel failed. Sometimes, you see, we believe that all that is in Israel is truth, and all that is outside of Israel is false. But can I tell you sometimes, even in Israel, we find truth and error. Jesus says, I am the true vine, and my Father, he said, is the husbandman. And I want you to understand clearly, Jesus is the true vine because that which he established and planted that should truly represent him failed. Notice as well, the Bible says that is my Father is the husbandman. Now, let me say this clearly. While the church represented in this parable may have all kinds of issues. This is to make careful of everybody. While the church, Israel, may have all kinds of issues, a branch can't cure or fix another branch. Hear me, somebody. Jesus is the vine. We are the branches. And his Father, the Bible says, he's the husbandman or the vine dresser. In other words, if there's something, Pastor Brown, wrong with the vineyard, wrong with the branches, wrong with some branches, the branch can't fix the branch. Only the vine dresser, only the husbandman, only the one who knows what true vine and true branches ought to look like can indeed fix the vineyard. Sometimes, you see, we got some issues because some of us sometimes feel that we are branches that are also assistant husbandman or vine dresser. You and I are branches. We don't have the capacity. We don't have the resources to fix branches that are not doing well. Let me put that out there. Jesus says, I am the true vine. And my Father is the husbandman. And notice something, saints of God. Israel, as the vine, was the true vine, not because they knew the sanctuary system. They were the true vine, not because they knew which day was the Sabbath. They were the true vine, not because they worshipped on Sabbath. Hear me, somebody. They were the true vine, not because they knew the truth about tithe and offering. They were the true vine, not because they knew that their body ought to be the temple of God. But they were the true vine because of what verse 2 tells us. Verse 2 tells us in John chapter 15 that every branch in me that beareth not fruit, he does what? Take it away, and every branch that beareth fruit, he does what? Purgeth it, that it may what? Bring forth fruit. In other words, they were the true vine, not because of what they know, but because of what they produced. You and I, brothers and sisters, we are a part. We are connected. All of us are connected to the true vine, Jesus. And we are true branches and true vine, true recipient of the vine, not because of what we look like. Understand this. The Bible says that there were some branches that didn't produce fruit. And there were some branches that did produce fruit. In other words, both branch that produced fruit and a branch that did not produce fruit were both connected to the vine. And I'm telling you, brothers and sisters, that you can have a branch that's not producing fruit that looks like the branch that's producing fruit. You see, the branch that's not producing fruit is not always withered up and dry. Sometimes it looks just as healthy and strong as the vine, as the branch that's producing fruit. It's a startling reality that the text is telling us that you and I can come to church and one of us could be connected to the vine and the other could be connected to the vine, but only one of us is producing fruit. And we have to be mindful that what makes us a branch that produces fruit is our connection to Jesus. But it's more than that. Because those that don't produce fruit also are connected to Jesus. So what it means, brothers and sisters, is not just a connection, but an intimate, a strong connection with Jesus that produces branches that produces fruit. All of us, I say to you, have some connection. The mere fact that we are here is because we have a connection. What makes us true branches that represent Jesus Christ as the vine is the fact that we produce fruit. And let me tell you clearly, that's not talking about necessarily about those that you bring to the baptismal pool. Because in this parable, John is trying to show us that the Godhead is at work here. God the Father, God the Son, and God the Holy Spirit. Can I help you with something? He says that the husbandman or the vine dresser is God the Father. He said that Jesus is what? The vine. Then the Holy Spirit must be the nutrients that carries food to the branches. In other words, Jesus is saying in this last I am statement that in order for you to be saved, you've got to be connected with the Father, the Son, and the Holy Spirit. And it's not just a connection that is a mere tap. It's a connection that is so tight that it's hard to let go. Even when the devil tried to pull you away, you're holding on for dear life because you understand that without Jesus, text says you'll be cut away. You know, I've told you this story before, and I thought of a new one this week, and I couldn't find another one that makes the point as best as this one does. So here you go again. Listen to it for the second time. Missionary went overseas. Remember the story already. Go with me anyway. Went overseas and they gave him a car to do his rounds. And he recognized that there was a problem with the car, that he had to park the car on a slope. And those of us who are from the islands understand when you have those standard cars, you park on a slope and it can't start and you put it in gear and you push it down the hill and it picks up a little bit of traction and then it starts. And for 3 years he was there in the mission field, and every time he wanted the car to start, he had to make sure he parked on a slope or have someone to push so it could start. His time came to an end, and new missionary came over and he said, here's the car that you're going to be using. There's only one unique thing about this car. You've got to park it on a slope or have someone to push it for you. The new missionary says, yeah, that sounds like a lot. He said, let me see. Let me open the hood and see what's going on. When he opened the hood, he recognized that the terminal for the batteries were loose. They were there. They were connected, but they weren't connected tightly enough. And so every time when the old missionary had someone pushing the car, all he had to do was open the hood, tighten the connection, and the car would start. I want to tell somebody that you have a connection with Jesus. But in order for your connection to produce fruit, for the car to move, you've got to tighten the connection. Spend more time in prayer. Spend more time in Bible study. Spend more time telling someone that Jesus is coming soon and real soon for a real prepared people. Tighten the connection. Jesus says, I am the true vine. And my Father is the husbandman. My Father is the vine dresser. And brothers and sisters, he said that in order for the vines that's going to really produce fruit, able to produce fruit, it can't just be a vine that is just hanging. It can't just be a branch, I'm sorry, that is just hanging off the vine. It must be a branch that is tightly connected to the vine. And that's why he says in verse 2, in verse 3, abide in me and I in you. As the branch cannot bear fruit of itself, except it abide in the vine, no more can he, except he abide in me. Well, let's not overlook this. I'm almost done. Verse 2 tells us that both branches, one that is connected tightly and receiving the nutrients and producing fruit, and the one that's not, both branches are pruned. One is cut away totally, the one that does not produce fruit, and the other that's producing fruit also is pruned. You see that in the text. It tells me, brothers and sisters, that if I am a branch not producing fruit, that Jesus says that the Father, the husbandman, will one day cut me away from the vine. And understand it, saints of God. You can be in the church every Sabbath and has been cut away because we have not been producing fruit for a very long time. And Jesus says, those of us who are producing fruit still got to get some pruning every now and again. You see, what makes a tomato plant really flourish and produce some of the best tomatoes you're going to ever see is that while the tomato plant is growing, sometimes there are some little buds right between the stem and the person who plants and understand how tomato grows need to cut those things away so that the tomato plant can grow. Sometimes, brothers and sisters, we have some little issues in our lives as Christians. Though we have been producing fruit, and I'm going to talk about the fruit in a minute, though we've been producing fruit, Jesus still has to cut away some stuff from us. Every now and again, we get ourselves caught up with some criticism, and Jesus said, I got to cut it off. Every now and again, we get caught up with some backbiting. We get caught up, saints of God, with feeling so prideful about ourselves. And Jesus said, I've got to cut some stuff off so you can produce good fruit. But the fruit that the Bible is talking about, I told you that from the vine to the branch is the Holy Spirit carrying the nutrients of the branch. So therefore, the fruit that we ought to produce are the fruit of the Spirit. Love, joy, peace, long-suffering, kindness, gentleness, saints of God. You see, sometimes we are so focused on trying to baptize folks and we have not learned or have not even know how to love, how to be kind, how to be gentle, how to be long-suffering. And we think, brothers and sisters, that our focus ought to be in bringing souls in when we ourselves need some fixing. Jesus says, if the branch abide in me and I in you, you'll bear great fruit. When the Bible says, if you abide in me, abiding there in the text means to dwell, to live. In other words, for you and I, where's the musician? For you and I, to produce fruit, we can't just have Jesus as a temporary dwelling. We have to dwell. We have to live with Jesus. Not just on Sabbaths for 2 hours. We've got to spend some time with Jesus. Not just on Sabbath, but 7 days a week. We've got to spend some time with Jesus in his words. We must dwell. We must live with Jesus in order to produce fruit. And saints of God, the issue as we have looked at all 7 I ams of Jesus is not about Jesus, but it's how we respond to Jesus who has promised and who has presented himself as everything to us. The evidence that we are branches that are producing fruit is not in what we know, but it's more importantly in what we produce. You see, we can know a whole lot about Jesus, but if we don't produce in our interactions with others the love of Jesus, then knowing about Jesus will not avail much. You see, we can know the truth about the Sabbath, but unless we become intimately acquainted with the Lord of the Sabbath, telling people about the Sabbath won't make a difference until they experience in us the Lord of the Sabbath. The evidence, brothers and sisters, will become overwhelming that we are children of God by the fruit that we produce, not by what we know cognitively. And as Seventh-day Adventists, too often we pride ourselves on what we know and not on what we produce. And I'm saying to us today, we ought to pride ourselves on the fruit. The evidence must be in the fruit, not in what I can quote from scriptures, but from what I produce. Folks who interact with me, they must interact with someone who have been with Jesus, someone who knows how to love, someone who knows how to forgive, someone who knows to show mercy, someone who can be kind, someone who knows when to be gentle. When folks interact with me, they must experience overwhelmingly the fruit. The question that we must ask ourselves today is simply this. Is there enough evidence that I have been with Jesus that will convict me any day of the week, not just on Sabbath, that people will know that I have been with Jesus, that I have experienced the love of Jesus? Is there enough evidence to convict me, not just on Sabbath, but every day wherever I go? The reality is, many of us will pass any test on Sunday. We know how to fit in on Sunday. We can fit in, and nobody will know the difference between us and everybody else. Monday at work, we can pass as just another worker. We can pass as just another secretary, another person on the production line, another teacher, another lawyer, another nurse. We can pass because we fit in quite well. But is there enough evidence that somebody who knows us well at work can say, I know that there was something different about you, because you don't laugh at certain jokes. You don't attend certain Christmas parties. You don't drink certain tea. You don't get ruffled when everything around here seems to be falling apart. It just seems like the heavens are so overwhelming that you experience peace that passes all understanding. When everybody's getting nervous, it just seems like you just have such confidence that somehow, some way, God is going to work it out. Is there enough evidence? That will convict us that we are producing the fruit of the Spirit. Jesus says, I am the true vine, and my Father is the vine dresser or the husbandman. Every branch that abides in me and I in him will produce fruit. Those branches who only abide in me on Sabbaths, I'm going to one day cut them off. Brothers and sisters, I thank God that seven times Jesus told us that he will be our all and in all. I'll be your bread. I'll be your good shepherd. I'll be your door. I'm your light. I'm your resurrection and the life. I am your way, the truth, and the life. I'm the true vine. The evidence is there. Jesus is clearly who he said he is. The question is, am I who I profess to be on Sabbath, Sunday, Monday, Tuesday, Wednesday, Thursday, and Friday? Listen to Cheryl as she sings. Good old hymn. The refrain says, I need no other evidence. I need no other plea. It is enough that Jesus died and rose again for me. Brothers and sisters, the issue has never been and will never be about Jesus. It's my response to Jesus. Listen.
My faith has found a resting place, not in a man-made creed. I trust the
before Cheryl sing the third stanza. The evidence is clear that Jesus is who he said he is, that Jesus will do what he said he'll do. But is the evidence clear that we are who we say we are, and we are doing what we say we will do? I need no other evidence. It is clear that Jesus is who he said he is 7 times. In John, I am. The question that I'd like us to consider after looking at these 7 I am statements of Jesus: just who am I? We know who Jesus is, but who am I? Am I the person on Sunday that I am on Sabbath? Am I the person living the songs that I sing about on Sabbath on Tuesday? Who am I? Brothers and my sisters, if your determination today by God's grace is to allow the evidence to overwhelmingly show that you are by God's grace, or you desire by God's grace to be the consistent you that God has created you to be, to honor him, to love him, to demonstrate all the fruit of the Spirit to others every day of the week, wherever we go, invite you to stand with us as Cheryl sings the third stanza. Let's make a commitment to God, asking him to help us to be who we ought to be. Cheryl sings the last stanza. You're here today. You know enough that Jesus has been consistently who he said he is. He has never disappointed you. He has never been less than who he said he is. But you want to be like Jesus. You've not yet accepted him as Lord and Savior. You know that about Jesus. Or you have not experienced him in a very intimate way. You want us to pray for you today. To have an intimate experience with Jesus. So that the evidence in your life will be one that is truth. One that demonstrates that you not only know about Jesus, but have an experience with him. Why don't you raise your hand? I want to pray for you. Not yet a member of the family of God here at Lebanon. But you want us to pray for you. Raise your hands high. I want to pray for you. That's my first appeal. Raise your hands high. I want to pray for you. Nothing wrong with Jesus. If anything wrong, it's with me. Nothing wrong with Jesus. He's faithful and true. I'm the one that messes up. I'm the one that makes mistakes. I'm the one that pretend to be what I'm not sometimes. But I want to be consistent. Raise your hand. I want to pray for you. Raise your hand high. God bless you. Pastor Brown, would you pray for us, please? And pray for the brothers and sisters who raise their hands, asking God to help them to be consistent.
Father, we need a connection with you, a living connection, a connection that motivates us to zealously repent and to seek a life in Christ that would save us from the wickedness that surrounds us. We ask that through your Holy Spirit, that you would invade every heart that needs invading, and that you would capture us for your kingdom, that you would divorce us from foolishness, and that you would fill us with a love for you that turns back anything that would alienate us from your soon coming kingdom of light. Grant that in that glad day we will all be there. Grant that we would have allowed nothing to come between us and you. Grant that we would get the victory and keep the victory and live the victory and share the victory and inspire the victory in somebody else's life as well. May we do what you put us here to do so that we can share eternity with you. In Jesus' name. Amen.